John King from Washington, what have you heard? What are we hearing for the last several hours?
Anderson, we are at what the administration believes is a critical moment of choice. They are very heartened and encouraged by not only the fact that the Army protected the demonstrators today, but that Field Marshal Tantawi got out and actually went and talked to them. Yes, he told them to go home. Yes, he told them their demands were on the way to being met, but they believe that was an important symbol. Now, here is the question in Washington and the question around the world. Did the Army do that to buy time for Mubarak to try to run out the clock, sap the energy out of the protesters, or did the Army do that as a signal? The administration is very cautiously but more optimistic tonight, Anderson, that as we head into the next week of this drama, Vice President Suleiman, Field Marshal Tantawi, will tell President Mubarak he must find a way out. Go to Sharm el-Sheikh, step back. If he doesn't absolutely officially cede power, at least recede from the picture and allow a more transitional government to step forward. They're not certain they're at that point, but I can tell you in their private conversations with the military, they're increasingly confident that the military will not be involved in any other crackdown. This is very hard to track because it is so secretive. The most secretive and probably the most fabulous and fascinating conversations months or years from now, when we actually get the details, would be Secretary of Defense Gates with Field Marshal Tantawi. But again, there's a smaller but noticeable sense of optimism tonight that they are going to resolve this over the course of the next week to 10 days.
Yeah, the diplomatic cables that are going back and forth must be extraordinary. Ben, you live in this region. You've reported it for so long. What is your sense as you look at the tea leaves?
Well, my feeling is, yes, John is right. They tried a crackdown. There's still a crackdown going on. In fact, even though in the square they're leaving them alone, human rights activists around Cairo have been rounded up. But I think what they're doing is they're just trying to wait it out. Let the demonstrations continue within the square itself, well aware that next week work starts again in Egypt. The stock market's open. People expect schools and universities to reopen. People have to get back to work. The protesters are even talking about a shift system whereby people will remain in the square, but those who need to go to work will have to go to work. So I think the government is just sitting, waiting for these people to get tired and to leave.
Professor Johnny, let me ask you this question. I don't have the facts on it, but my sense is, and I don't like to verge into analysis, but I think you're better at that and more comfortable with it. My sense is that, do you believe the pro-Mubarak mobs, protesters, whatever you want to call them, who went and attacked, was an effort by the state to essentially try to push out the protesters without having their fingerprints anywhere near it, and they were perhaps surprised, or maybe it was a test, but that the protesters battled back and held the square, and therefore the state had to capitulate.
Absolutely.
Or change tactics.
You're absolutely on the mark. I mean, in fact, for this probings that have been going on, you can do this with goons, you can do this with Secret Service people, you can do this with plainclothes policemen, but for the big crackdown, you have to do it, and you need the army to do that kind of crackdown. But there's no doubt they're testing the courage of these protesters, because fundamentally I believe, and I believe throughout the story, that Hosni Mubarak never really took these people seriously. He thought they would scurry for cover. He thought they could intimidate them. He thought that they could frighten them. And I think in many ways, Mubarak has in him something of Ahmadinejad. I mean, the idea would be that you would have something of a crackdown akin to what the Iranian regime did in 2009. But Egypt is not Iran. The circumstances are different. And Egypt is under the gaze of the world and, to a considerable extent, under the gaze of the United States. And I think there is an enormous amount of American influence, not so much public diplomacy, what the president says, but behind the scenes, the message has gone out to the regime in Cairo and to Hosni Mubarak as to what the U.S. can and cannot bear.
The state here, Ben, firmly denies that attacks on journalists have in any way been coordinated by the state. And yet today, they seem to suddenly, mysteriously, across the board in various parts of town, ease up somewhat, though some offices have been ransacked, and as you said, human rights workers have now been targeted. Is that just a coincidence?
No, I don't think it is. I think that they got so much bad press because the world watched on live television as for 15 hours this onslaught occurred and the army just stood by. Today, nothing's going on. I think it's obvious. This is in some way directed by people within the government and the National Democratic Party, the ruling party. Can you find a direct link? Probably not, but it's there. It's there. There's no question. It doesn't, you know, rain one day and parts the next.
I keep thinking what Dr. Ajami said several nights ago when he said that Mubarak is using the playbook of Saddam Hussein. And I keep thinking as I watch these events that there is a playbook and that they are kind of, you know, okay, we'll try not using the military, but we'll try sending thugs to beat them up, and that doesn't work, they switch to something else.
It's a playbook not unique to either this place or Saddam Hussein's Iraq. They study it throughout the region.
We're going to have a lot more from this region, more with Dr. Ajami and John King, Ben Wiedemann. Also, this video now that has surfaced on YouTube, causing a lot of consternation in many different circles, a white van, diplomatic van, it appears. U.S. government saying these vans were stolen. We'll explain the video and what is being said about it.